Good evening, everybody. We're glad that you are here tonight for Monday Night Bible Study. If it's your very first time with us live in the room, would you lift your hand for us very quickly? Excellent. Welcome. We are glad that you're here. My name is Pastor Jeremy Marrone, and I get the privilege and honor of being on staff here at Lakewood Church and being part of the Monday Night teaching team. And so we're glad that you are here. That you are glad that you are a part of what God is doing in this community of believers. And I want to take a moment just to welcome everybody that's watching online, wherever you are around the world. If you're in Houston or somewhere else in the world, we just want to say thank you for tuning in and being a part. And we consider you our extended family. Even though you're online digitally, we consider you our extended family. We have small groups meeting around the city who are watching tonight. So shout out to those groups. We're glad that you're a part. And so here's what we do. When we come together on Monday nights, we like to take the Word of God and be transformed. The information is good, but what the Holy Spirit does through the information is transform us. Amen? He works in us both to will and to do God's good pleasure. And so as believers, as those who come to the Word of God and say, God, show us, what does it mean? We don't want just information. I like information. I like the backstory, I like context, I like all of the detail. But most importantly, that the Holy Spirit would work in us. And as He works in us, we become more and more and more like our Savior. And so tonight we plan to do that. We're going to be in the book of 2 Timothy in the second chapter. If you need notes, we have notes here in the room. If you're watching online, you can go online, lakewoodchurch.com, and get the notes on there as well. We have the notes posted for you tonight. We're so glad that you guys are a part. And I want to say, if you want a text out from us on a regular basis, we have a text in, and it's Bible Study to 77377. Bible Study to 77377. And that will be just a regular text that will come out to you to know what's going on. Next week, Pastor Lisa is on the schedule, and the week after that, we have Eric Lucetta, who's going to be teaching, and so they're going to be doing the next couple chapters, and so we're excited about that. I always like to start with prayer before we get into the Word. I know a lot of us we had a long day today, maybe we had a work day today, maybe we had school today, if you're studying or whatever it may be, and so whatever's going on in your world, I'd love to take a moment for us just to pray. The Bible says whatever we have going on in our life, whatever concerns us, bring it to God. Bring it through His Son, Jesus. Bring it to Him and lay it at His feet. And so He said, whatever is concerning you, bring it to Me. And so what we want to do to find rest tonight in life, let's take a moment, a rest in our souls. Let's take a moment and go to our Heavenly Father and just say, God, You know what's going on in my world. So whether it be financial, whether it be family, whether it be school, whether it be direction, whether it be a relationship, whatever, if it's whatever's going on, if it's career, promotion, worry or fears about the future or things going on, maybe a health issue, I would love for us to take it and pray about it. So those of you watching online, if you'd like to pray as well, I'd like to take a moment. Whatever you have, let's lay it before the Lord tonight and pray. Father, we thank You that You are good, and we thank You that You love us and that You've called us, and we thank You, God, that You hear our prayer when we pray. And so, God, whatever concerns us tonight, whatever things we have going on in our world, whether it be physical health, Father, whether it be money issues, whether it be family issues, whether it be career, direction, God, we're asking You for direction and guidance in a decision or an opportunity. If there's business people watching, God, that need direction and wisdom in making a decision. Father, if any of us in our health are unhealthy, I pray, God, that You would heal right now in the name of Jesus. Father, that You would bring healing. Father, we believe You for it. We thank You, God, for mending relationships. We thank You, God, for bringing clarity in relationships. God, we thank You for bringing family members who don't know You home. We thank You, God, for touching the hearts of the next generation who may be watching. And Father, we thank You for all that You're doing in this place. So God, we lay before You all of our concerns. We lay before You all of the things that we have going on in our life. And I pray, God, that You would give us peace and wisdom and knowledge and understanding as we move forward. Holy Spirit, thank You for giving us exactly what we need in this moment. In Jesus' name, and everybody said,
Amen.
Amen. Amen. God hears us clearly. We're going to be in 2 Timothy, the book of 2 Timothy tonight, chapter 2, 2 Timothy chapter 2, and we are going to start there. We've been going through 1 Timothy, and now we are in 2 Timothy, and we are in chapter 2, and this is what most scholars believe to be Paul's final letter that he wrote, his final letter that he wrote before his death. And he was writing it from prison, and he was writing it to a young man named Timothy, who was his protege. He was writing it to a young man who was a young pastor, a young leader in his church in Ephesus, and he was writing it to Timothy to give him instruction on how to lead in a church that was struggling. There were people that were coming in that were dynamic leaders who were coming in, and they were trying to take the people off a path in beliefs and doctrines and teachings that were not Christ-centered teachings. And so what Paul's doing with Timothy in these letters is he's actually giving him instruction. He's teaching this young leader how to stand up, how to preach the truth, number one. Number two, how to hold people accountable. And number three, how to face those who were knowingly drawing people away from what was the truth and the doctrines of, at that time, the way of following Jesus, and taking them in a direction that was not the truth. And so Paul's writing these letters to Timothy to help him with his leadership. He's a young man who we know was writing back and forth with Paul. Paul's answering questions that he was probably sending to Paul while he was in prison. And there was at one point even Paul urges Timothy to come and see him in prison. But in this book, in 2 Timothy, you see in chapters 1 and the first half of chapter 2, you see Paul urging Timothy to accept his calling. All of us, every one of us in this room has a calling. All of us has a calling before God. If you're breathing, you have a purpose and a calling from God. Okay? And your calling is what God has given to you to fulfill the purpose of your life in this earth. And so what Paul is saying to Timothy is, I want you to accept the calling that I've given to you. Now, all of us have that. And so I guess my first question would be tonight is, have we accepted the call that God has given to us? Have we answered the call? I have somebody buzzing right now on my cell phone. I'm not going to answer it. But normally we would, you know, that it comes up. You have a cell phone, it comes up, and you have the red button, you have the green button. When somebody calls you and you go, I know this is going to be a 30-minute conversation. I'm going to wait on this one. Let's be honest. All of us have that. That person calls and you go, maybe not. In your mind, you're saying, am I going to answer the call? But every day when we wake up, it's that same thing from God. Will we answer the call today again to follow him? Will we answer the call today to fulfill the purpose that he's given to us? Every single day, we have that opportunity to answer the call. Amen? We have the opportunity to answer the call in our families. We have the opportunity to answer the call in our workplace, in our careers, in school. If you're a student, you answer the call to fulfill what God has for you as a student right now. And so Paul is doing this exact same thing with Timothy. He's like, Timothy, will you answer the call that God has given to you? I can help you, but will you answer it? Because nobody's going to force you to stand up and be the leader, but God's called you to it. Will you do it? And so this is a young leader who's sort of battling this and going, do I have what it takes? All of us have that question, don't we? At somewhere in our gut, we all have the question, we all have to answer the question, do I have what it takes to answer the call of God? The answer is yes, only because God empowers us. But we still have that question in our human soul, don't we? Do I have what it takes? Well, with Jesus, yes. And so we all answer that same call that Paul gave Timothy. In the second half of chapter 2 and on into all the way through the fourth chapter of 2 Timothy is Paul's instructions to Timothy to deal with false teaching about Jesus. And so as we get into the first half of chapter 2, it's the call. The second half of chapter 2 tonight is going to be the beginning of Paul instructing Timothy on how to deal with people in his church who were false teachers and saying, hey, keep the body, keep the people of that community on the right track with what the truth is. And so we see him answer that. Now, Timothy was young, he was timid, and he got a pep talk. This chapter is a pep talk from his mentor. This whole chapter is a pep talk. Timothy was a young man, he was timid, and he was a clergy. He was a young man, he was timid, and he was a clergy. So my question is, what does that have to do with us if we're not young, if we're not timid, and we're not a clergy, which is a vocational pastor? What does this have to do with us? I'm glad you asked. Here's what we're going to talk about tonight. This applies to all of us, whether we're Timothy, we're young and timid and a clergy, or we're not. This applies to all of us. And as we go through this chapter, I want to help us see how this applies to us. He's writing it to Timothy, but it makes sense for us, and it's relevant to us still today, even from the first century, from 2 Timothy, his final letter. It still matters to us today that we answer these same things that Paul is laying out for Timothy. So some of this language is pastoral language, but it still applies to us. Some of this is language of a leader in a church. Maybe you're that, maybe you're not, but it still applies to us in life. And we'll see where we can dig in here, get the gold, and take from it so that we can apply it in our own lives. Let's start with chapter 2, verse 1. We're going to start there. And from there, we're gonna read a little bit, and then I want to stop at different points and point out a couple of things in the scriptures. In verse 1 of chapter 2, it says this: "You then, my child," this is Paul writing to Timothy, "you then, my child, be strengthened by the grace." Everybody say, "by the grace."
By the grace.
"Be strengthened by the grace that is in Jesus Christ." Now, that word grace in the Greek simply means the kindness, the favor of God in Jesus. It is a power that is given to us by the Holy Spirit for the sake of the good news, the gospel of Jesus. And so what Paul is doing is he's exhorting Timothy, listen, you have God's grace, you have God's power, you have God's kindness, you have God's favor. And that's what grace is. It is God's unmerited favor. It is God's empowering work in the believer. And so he's telling Timothy, you have this grace, and be strengthened by the grace. The writer of Hebrews says in Hebrews 12, it says, your heart, it is good that your heart be established by grace. It is not just the kindness of God in forgiveness and repentance. It's the empowering nature of the Holy Spirit's work in us as believers. So the grace of God is what empowers us to answer the call of God. The grace of God is what empowers us to answer the call that God has for us in his work in the kingdom, his work in the earth, his work to leave a mark, to be the light. And so he's telling Timothy, be strengthened by that grace. Don't forget it and set it aside. But even in the struggles, even in the things you're facing, even being called names, even being shouted down as a young leader in the church. We saw it in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, if you've been following the last few weeks. He said, don't let anybody look down on you because you're young, but you be the example in love, in purity, in faith, in all of the areas of the community. You be an example. It doesn't matter how young you are. So all of us must continue to be established and strengthened by God's grace. So that's point number one. We must be established in our heart and strengthened by God's grace that is in Christ Jesus. Verse 2, and what you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust this, give this away to faithful men. Give this away to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. This message that you have heard in my presence, give this away. So the result, let me just say it like this, the result of you and I being strengthened by God's grace, the result of you and I being strengthened in our heart by God's grace is that when we are strengthened by grace, we give it away. Here's the thing about God's grace. Sometimes you give it away and you don't even realize you're giving it away. Let me prove it. Matthew chapter 25, Jesus is speaking. And he told his followers, he said, when I was sick, you took care of me. When I was hungry, you fed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, you came and visited me. And this is what they said. They said, when did we do that? And he said, when you've done it unto the least of these, you've done it unto me. Here's the point. They were honoring God with their life, and they didn't even realize it. Now, do we know when we're honoring God with our lives? Yes, we can. Absolutely. But there are times God is working in your life that you are being the light. You don't realize you're being the light in that moment. The grace of God transforms the human heart in such a way that it emanates from us. It just flows. So let me encourage you. Walking as God desires, walking as Jesus, is simply by grace. It's the work of the Holy Spirit in us to answer the call to be fully human in this world. And to be fully human is by God's grace. So Paul's challenging him. What I've given to you, what I've entrusted to you, this message that I've given to you, give it to other people who will teach other people as well. Let's give it away. So the second point tonight is give it away. Be strengthened by the grace of God and then give it away. Verse 3, share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ. Now there's a couple of pictures of imagery. Paul tends to do this in his writings. He does it all through the New Testament in the letters that he writes. He mixes his metaphors and his imagery. In Thessalonians, he talks about a soldier with armor on, and then he talks about a pregnant woman, and then he talks about a guy being drunk at night, and then he talks about, like, he mixes these metaphors in his passages because he's trying to use earthly pictures, word pictures, for you and I to understand and for Timothy to understand. You and I do it every day, all right? We use metaphors in our life. We use imagery in our life all the time to prove things. I was just talking with Eric Lucetta right before we started Monday Night Bible Study tonight, and I said, you know, sometimes I use the phrase, like, to my children, I'm like, I've told you a million times. Well, I haven't. I mean, maybe cleaning their room, I've said it a million times. It's close. It's really, really close. Or you've said, you know, that computer cost me an arm and a leg. Well, I'm hoping not. I'm hoping it hasn't. But we use imagery, we use metaphors, don't we? In everyday life, we don't even think about it. And so, I was at the DMV forever. Forever. That one may be true. That one may be true. Bad example. But what Paul does here is he uses imagery to help teach Timothy. So he says this, in verse 3, he says, share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ. Soldier, number one, that's the first metaphor. Number two, verse 4, no soldier gets entangled in civilian pursuits since his aim is to please the one who enlisted him. So Paul is starting to exhort him and call him out and say, Timothy, I don't want you to get ensnared in a bunch of stuff that's happening at that church. I want you to rise above that, and I want you to lead. I want you to do what you've been called to do. And so he's saying, there are certain things when you're called and enlisted, there are certain things you don't get worried about or entangled in or arguments, and we'll talk about what those are in just a few minutes. But you don't get into certain, you don't get in the weeds in certain ways in life when God has called you to something. And this pertains to all of us, and this is really important. But the second thing he says is verse 5. He says, an athlete is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. Verse 6, it is hard-working farmers who ought to have the first share of the crops. Think over what I say, verse 7. Think over what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Now, he's just mixed in four verses, he's just mixed three different metaphors. A soldier, an athlete, and a farmer. And he uses all of them as human examples to basically say all three of these people have a calling that is something bigger than themselves, in which they have to endure hard work in order to obtain a greater goal. And I put it in your notes, the greatest of all this is Jesus. Jesus came to accomplish a goal that was bigger than just him, much bigger than just him. So Paul is using this metaphor to say, just as Jesus walked through his call, just as Jesus responded, you and I do the same thing. We don't get entangled in the things that don't matter. We focus on what matters most. We keep the main thing, which is a point I'll get to later. but we keep the main thing the main thing. And so Paul is exhorting Timothy, Timothy, listen, listen. There's a whole bunch of arguing. There's bickering in the church there in Ephesus. There's a whole lot of backbiting. There's a whole lot of people saying, I'm right, and this person's right. And there's a whole lot of, like, taking sides and people, you know, getting, you know, just getting irate and angry and just divisions and stuff like that. And Paul is saying, listen, the most important thing that you're going to do is you're going to bring everything back on track. And you're going to do that by setting the target of the truth and everybody answering to that. Because that's what it is. Jesus laid out the truth from the beginning, and we all must adhere to what the truth is. And so Paul's telling Timothy, that's what I want you to do. I don't want you to get focused on all these other detailed things, many of them that are worthless, arguments and all kinds of stuff that does not matter. I want you to focus on the most important thing, and that's to establish what the truth is according to what you have been taught. Now, Timothy was a Jew. His mother and grandmother were famous, actually. They were well known, and they were people who had established a spiritual legacy for him. And so Timothy knew, as a young Jewish man, he understood what it meant to have that call. He understood what the truth was, because it had been established by him, by his mom and his grandmother. And so we see this Paul exhorting him, don't get caught up in those things. Jesus had a goal. These same people have a goal. A soldier has a goal. An athlete has a goal. A farmer has a goal, and they don't get distracted with all of the other things, which is a really good reminder for us in life. Many times, listen, there are important details, but a lot of the details in life that we tend to focus on or that we can get entrapped in don't matter as much, do they? We can get into things that don't matter as much that can distract us. So one of the most important things we can do is not get distracted with things that don't matter. Don't give your energy, your mental, emotional, or physical energy to things that don't matter. And one of those is people who don't like you. Amen. Go where you're celebrated, not where you're tolerated. How about that? Amen. Go where you're celebrated, not tolerated. I think we should all have friends. And I think all of us have people in our lives that we felt tolerated us, but we also have people in our lives that celebrate us. And I think that's, I don't want to get too narrow on just that, like our friends, but that's a really immediate thing. That's a practical thing in our everyday lives that we go, hey, I want to be around people who build me up, who encourage me, who challenge me, right? And so we can see that even in this chapter, Paul's doing that with Timothy. All right, moving on. Verse 8. Paul uses another poem. In 1 Timothy, the book, he used several poems. But this is the same thing Paul's doing again with Timothy. He's reminding him of a poem, but he's talking about doctrine. He's talking about doctrine, excuse me. Doctrine just means teaching. So he's reminding Timothy about teachings of Jesus that are the truth, the things that are solidified in the gospel, the good news, the things that matter, the things of the way. And Paul does it once again in this chapter. He reminds Timothy, Timothy, the point to all of this is the fact that you remember Jesus Christ, verse 8, risen from the dead, the offspring of David. Now, the point of this is Timothy, as a good Jewish young man, would understand the history of his people. He would understand what Paul is telling him. The offspring of David, he would have thought about the book of Psalms, where it talks about the offspring of David. He would have thought about, and I wrote it in our notes, Luke chapter 1, verses 30 through 33. The angel said to her, this is Mary, Luke chapter 1, verses 30 through 33. And the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. This is the angel coming to Jesus' mother Mary and telling her that she will bear a son. For you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and that you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Timothy would have known this. Paul's reminding him This is the focus that you need to be focused on. All this arguing, all these other leaders, all of this back and forth, this is the main thing. Remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, the offspring of David. He is the Messiah, and that's what I want you to focus on. As preached in my gospel, the second part of verse 8. As preached in my gospel, verse 9. For which I am suffering, bound with chains as a criminal. But the word of God is not bound. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. He's calling Timothy, Timothy, your number one focus is not to get into the weeds of all this. It's to correct, and then it's to direct people to say, this is about the Messiah. This is about Jesus. This is about them following the truth, the way, as it was called in the first century. The way. This is about teaching people about the way. And these are the truths that you have held since you were little. These are the things that you would have understood from your mother and your grandmother. These are the things that you would have known as a good Jewish young man. These are the things that you would focus on in life. And so he's telling him, listen, this same gospel that I'm literally suffering for, this same gospel that I am enchained because of, the gospel is not chained. And his whole point is, he's saying, Timothy, I'm taking this exact gospel that I'm in chains for and giving it to you, and it's still going around. So even though I'm stationary in one place being chained, the gospel is still going forth. And according to Romans 1, the gospel is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, first the Jew and the Gentile. So he's reminding Timothy, Timothy, this is your calling. This is your calling. He's probably answering a question that Timothy's probably saying, in because we don't have all of the other writings outside of this, but he's probably answering some sort of question. Timothy's going, Paul, what do I do? What do I say? And Paul keeps coming back. This is the second time. I taught a chapter in 1 Timothy. This is the second time in two chapters that I've taught that he's given him a poem about the person of Jesus, his death, his resurrection, his messiahship. So Paul keeps coming back to that. He's like, Timothy, Timothy, you're off getting all of these detailed things, and I'm telling you, focus on this. Speak the truth. Speak the truth. Amen? Speak the truth. Therefore, I endure, verse 10, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, that they also may obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. I'm guessing Timothy had one of those moments where he was asking Paul, Paul, is this worth it? Is this worth it? Is this worth it to get all this heat? Is this worth it? To get all of this anger and this frustration and all of these things I got to deal with? Is this worth it? He's a young man. He's a young man coming up as a leader, and he's asking Paul, who's weathered the storms of being in chains and beaten and all kinds of persecution. And Paul is telling him, for the sake of the people who will believe because of what you say, yes, it is worth it. And so for all of us, we have that same challenge. We are not exempt as followers of Jesus. We are not exempt from going through challenges in life. We're not exempt from tribulation and trial. But the question is it worth it? And the answer is yes. It is worth it. Yes, it is. It is worth it. Why? Because people matter. This isn't about, listen, this is not about me selling computers at Best Buy. If you're from Best Buy and you sell computers, awesome. My friend in Austin does it. He sells Apple computers. But that's not what life is about. Jesus said in Luke 16, he said, if I can trust you with the little things, I can trust you with the great things. And the great things are the true riches of the kingdom, which is people. So you and I are answering the call from God, even if we go through trial and tribulation. Why? Because it's worth it. Why? Because people matter. Because people matter to God. And we get to be in the, as 2 Corinthians 5 says, we get to be in the reconciling, the reconciliation business. We get to help reconcile people to God. He does it, but we get to help. We get to help them find hope, and we get to love, and we get to lift. And Timothy's in this business now, and Paul's telling him, Timothy, it's worth it. I'm in chains over here, and I'm telling you, it's worth it, because you get to be the mouthpiece now. Amen. You get to be the mouthpiece, and it's worth it. Why? Because people matter. Because the people that God has called, they matter. And so for all of us, I mean, look around. Look around. There are people from everywhere in the world in this room. From everywhere. And what happens is we get to be the light. We get to be the mouthpiece that God sends out into the world. And we get to love people wherever we are. You watching online, you get to love people wherever you live. You get to help them. You get to bring hope. You get to give. You get to serve. You get to love them toward Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
So all of us get to answer that call. And Paul's reminding him. Paul urges Timothy to answer the calling, to understand the calling, to live for the sake of the good news. Verse 11, the saying is trustworthy, Paul says. This saying is so trustworthy. For if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we have died with him, he's talking about the ultimate sacrifice of persecution. Paul's not necessarily talking about a spiritual death here. He's talking about actual death. If we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. It's pretty straightforward language. Matthew chapter 10, verses 32 through 33, Jesus said this, so everyone who acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But to whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Paul is reminding him, this is a really important mission. This is a really important mission. Because when the truth goes forth, people make a decision, yes or no. When the truth goes out, the truth always forces us as human beings to make a decision about what we believe and what we don't believe. And so Paul is telling him, listen, this is really important. And so even though we may suffer the ultimate death, Jesus has conquered that. Jesus put to death death. So even as believers, Paul uses the word, they have fallen asleep. Even in this life, if we have fallen asleep, we will ultimately live forever with God. When he returns and he brings all of creation back to its rightful place. And so Paul is exhorting him. Verse 13, if we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. God is faithful to what he has said. Whatever our position of faithfulness is, he is always faithful, period. And he's faithful to what he has given and promised to Jesus. Amen? And you and I share in that. Ephesians chapter 1, if you want to look it over, Ephesians chapter 1, we have every spiritual blessing in Christ in heavenly places because of Jesus. And what God has promised to his Son, we receive because we are in Christ, in his family. And he's saying the faithfulness of God does not move, even if we're faithless. This poem is stating, while we're suffering for the sake of Christ, even if death were to come against us, Christ as Messiah has triumphed over death. He has broken the ultimate end. The ultimate insult to humanity is that humanity would die physically. And Jesus came to break that. And in the end, you and I will live forever with God because Jesus has come and broken that. Verse 14, remind them of these things and charge them before God not to fight or quarrel about words, which does no good but only ruins the hearers. Do your best to present yourself to God as one who is approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, who is rightly handling the word of truth. Paul is telling him, do your best, Timothy. Give everything you can. To avoid the chatter, to avoid the babble, to avoid the arguing, and handle the truth correctly. As we said earlier, he's like, I've given you this one mission from God to speak the truth. But avoid, verse 16, but avoid irreverent babble, for it will lead people into more and more ungodliness, and their talk will spread like gangrene, like infection. Among them, Paul does this every now and then. He calls people out. Among them are, let's name names, buddy. Here they are. Among them are Hymenaeus and Philetus, who are false teachers, who have swerved from the truth. If you've ever been in a car, you slammed on the brakes and swerved out of the way of something. It's a quick jolt. The language he's using here is they have quickly moved off of what is the truth. And they're trying to bring people with them. And he's calling them out saying, hey, I want you to focus on these two people. There are other people, but these are specific people. Now, if Paul's writing and he puts your name in there, you've obviously made some noise in the community. If he's naming names, you've made noise. So he's helping him. These are specific people who are false teachers. They've changed from the truth. They've moved off of the truth. They are saying things with their words that the resurrection has already happened. They are upsetting the faith of some. They're saying that the resurrection has already happened. People are scared. People are scared. Well, what about us? And Paul's telling them, tell them the truth. Tell them the truth. Come in and override the false things that they're teaching, because it's scaring people and it's not the truth. Verse 19, but God's firm foundation stands, bearing his seal. The Lord knows who are his, and let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. That word there in the Greek is injustice or unrighteousness. So Paul's telling him, this infectious thing that has happened with these false teachers, come in, lay down the truth, the foundation of the truth. The reason he went through the poem earlier, a few verses earlier, is to remind him of the foundation of the truth, that Jesus is who he says he was, that he's done what he said he would do, namely, die, number one. Number two, be raised from the dead. And then number three, he is established by his heavenly Father as the Messiah. And so the Lord knows who are his. Let everyone who names the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. That's unrighteousness. It's important for us to show and bear the fruits of repentance before God. It's important for us to walk in the ways of God through the person of Jesus Christ, empowered by the Holy Spirit. In verse 20, now in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honorable use and some for dishonorable use. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from what is dishonorable, he will be a vessel, for honorable use, set apart as holy, useful to the master of the house, ready for every good work. That is a challenge to Timothy to say, the people that are following God are showing the fruits of good work. Works are not the ingredients of our faith. Works are the evidence of our faith. We can't put our works together and be righteous before God, but they will follow when we have believed. By grace, they will follow. And so Paul's telling him, every good work is prepared for those who in the house are useful to the master. And in verse 22, he gives him some more commendation, and he calls him, and he basically tells him, this is how you will look for those who are false, and this is how you will look for those who are true. These are the things to look for, to say these people are the false teachers, these ones are the false leaders trying to take people away. You will know them by the fruit that is going on in their life, whether they are of the truth or not. Verse 22. So he tells them, so flee the youthful passions and pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace, along with those who call on the Lord from a pure heart. Have nothing to do with foolish, ignorant controversies. You know what they breed, that they breed quarrels. Again, he comes back to it. He says it in verse 14 and 15. He says it only ruins the hearers. It only ruins what's going on in their heart and their mind and their soul. It only ruins that. And so I'm telling you not to get into quarrels and all of those things. I'm telling you to stand up. I'm telling you to speak the truth. I'm telling you to lay the foundations of the gospel once again, and then to watch for the fruits that are coming out in people's lives. Have nothing to do with foolish, ignorant controversies. You know that they breed quarrels. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil. Pretty tough challenge. The Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone. How many of you would say, don't raise your hand. How many of you would think in life it's hard to be kind to everyone all the time? Okay, got some hand raisers. I appreciate that. Honesty. But here's the thing about walking with God. You know, I used to, I didn't live for the Lord when I was in junior high and high school. And I had a lot of friends that didn't follow the Lord. And and so I, you know, I made some terrible decisions. But the interesting thing about it is when I gave my life to the Lord at 19, I had a lot of friends that were like, first of all, why do you want to do that? Why do you want to follow Jesus? You're not going to get to do what you want to do anymore. And I said, well, I said, it's not that. I said, it's, I get to do what I want. It's just my wants have changed. I don't want to do those things anymore. So one of the things that I do is I would be really mean and angry with people. And I was not a very good friend at times. I was harsh. I would lie. I would stab people in the back. I would manipulate and those things. And my desire was not to do that anymore because it hurts people. So my desires changed. But the point about it is this. Somebody told me one time, they made this statement. And they said, you know, it's really hard to be a Christian. And I said, no, it's not hard. It's impossible. But that's why we have the Holy Spirit. Walking with Jesus is impossible. But we're empowered from on high. That's the only way that walking with the Lord Jesus is possible, is that we're empowered in and of ourselves. Even that question of, is it hard to be kind to people all the time? In many ways, yes. But in Galatians 5, 22 and 23, the nine fruits of the Holy Spirit, that's the whole point to having the Holy Spirit, is that he would empower us to produce fruit. And so if we go all the way back to the beginning of the chapter, if we're empowered by grace, it's a whole lot easier to be kind to people because we're empowered by a power that is not our own. And many times we have desires, you know, like that person that gets under our skin and we're just like, God bless you. Bless you. But we all do, and it's hard to be kind all the time in our own strength. Well, it's impossible in our own strength. But that's the nature of walking with the Lord. Is that it is something that is empowered by the Spirit of God. And so as we walk with God, just as Paul's encouraging Timothy, as we're empowered by grace, that's the only way that Timothy can actually fulfill these commands from Paul. Hey, be gentle and be kind with people. But that's only an empowering by the Holy Spirit. Do you realize the ninth fruit of the Holy Spirit is self-control? And it's kind of it would seem like an oxymoron that we're empowered by the Holy Spirit to have self-control. But literally in the Greek, it's a word that means controlled of our own will and volition, but empowered from a source that's not our own. It's a bit of a mystery. But kindness, even though it seems simple at times, is sometimes one of the hardest things we can do when we don't want to be kind to somebody, especially when they're not kind to us, right? But that's the beauty of what Paul is calling on Timothy to do, is the very first thing he said is be strengthened in grace, because you will face all of these things and you won't want to be kind, but you'll need to. Why? We're going to go on and finish it. Verse 25, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant them repentance leading to a knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape from the snare of the devil after being captured by him to do his will. What is the point of being kind and gentle, but empowered by the Holy Spirit, is that when people see your life or hear your life, they may respond this way. They may be empowered. They may see that repentance is what they need. So our pastor Joel says it all the time. He's like, however people treat you, you be kind back to them. You can't control how they treat you, but you can control how you treat them. And here's the thing. If you have somebody who mistreats you, you may have found somebody who's hurting. And they may need the very thing that you possess, and that's a relationship with the Lord Jesus. You may have the very thing that they're looking for, and that's hope. And so even though they treat you a certain way, how we handle that, how we are empowered by the grace of the Holy Spirit in order to love and be kind and gentle and to answer somebody, not with a harsh word, but with a gentle word. The Bible says in Psalms and Proverbs that a harsh word stirs up anger, but a soft word is received. And so as you and I are empowered and strengthened in grace, what happens is when we are kind to people who are not kind to us, it breaks down walls. It softens the heart for somebody to receive the very thing that you and I have received. And that's the hope that we get to give. So there's four things in this chapter that Paul does with Timothy. Number one, he encourages him, be confident in the gospel. Be confident in this good news. Be confident in the truth that you have received. Be confident in it. Because here's the beauty of it. Your power is not what changes the human heart. It's the gospel itself. It's the good news. It's the hope of God that changes the human heart. Paul's saying, I just want you to stand up and say it. That's number one. Number two, we get to turn away from iniquity. We are empowered by the Spirit of God to turn away from our old life, to take off the old man and put on the new. We are empowered by the Holy Spirit to walk in freedom. We are empowered by the Holy Spirit to walk in grace. We are empowered by the Holy Spirit to walk in life and not allow the habits, the sin, the things from the past to anchor us, but to be freed from that so that you and I can walk as God intends. Number three, don't get involved in careless arguments which create hostility. Don't waste your time. That's basically what I'm saying. In life, we have a certain number of days that God has mapped out according to Psalm 139, verses 17 and 18. He's mapped out a certain number of days for us. And so my encouragement to you is this. Don't get into the weeds about little things that don't matter. Keep the main thing in your relationships, in marriage, in friendships, at school, in your career. Keep the main thing. You have a calling from God that is very important. And God is calling us to fulfill that. And what his desire for us to do is not to get caught up in the things that are... that are fruitless and contentious, but he wants us to be laser focused on whatever he's given for us to do. Don't get caught up with other things. Now, here's what I'll say. This doesn't mean we don't have an answer for the hope that's within us. It's good to have an answer. We need to know why we have hope within us. I think what Paul is exhorting us to do is not to argue and be quarrelsome and contentious. We can have an answer for the hope that's within us, but we don't have to be quarrelsome and contentious and argue and fight with other people about it. The truth, I love what Tim Keller, the great theologian, said. He said, the truth is like a lion. You don't have to defend it. Just let it loose. It'll defend itself. The truth is the truth. And number four, deal with people with gentleness and kindness regarding the truth. And Paul says they may come to their senses. So here's what we can do as believers. Empowered by the grace of God, strengthened by the grace in our heart of what God is doing in our lives, you and I can be the light to the world. We can be a billboard to say, this is the way God intended for us to live. You don't have to live in the place that you've been living. You don't have to live in the hopelessness in which you've been living. You don't have to live in the shame and the guilt in which you've been living. God has offered us by his Son. He has offered us the new life, not a better life, a new life. And so you and I get to be that billboard. And so tonight, as we leave this week, let's be empowered by God in the grace that he has given to us. And let's, with gentleness and kindness, but toughness, let's love people with hope and love and lift them with the truth. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for tonight. We thank you, God, what you've spoken to us through your word. We thank you, God, that you've called us, that you've challenged us, God, that you've given us giftings, that you've given us a purpose, God, that we have an assignment from you in this life, and God, we don't take that lightly. We know that it's over all, that everything we do is under that banner of you've called us. So we want to answer that call tonight. And Father, empower us by your grace. Strengthen us in our hearts, that our hearts would be established by your grace, that as those fruits, as those good works come out of our lives, God, that other people would see it and they would honor and glorify you. And Father, that their hearts would be changed. Father, we pray that you would help us to be the hope and the light of Jesus, that we would love and lift those. And Father, may we do it with kindness and gentleness. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We will see you next week right here at 7:30 once again with Pastor Lisa Gomez. Thank you.